Hey, welcome to the Small Business Made Simple podcast, brought to you by socialmediaandmarketing.com.au. Being in business is never easy, but it can be simple, or at least simpler. Join me, your host Jen Donovan, every week where we focus on marketing, social media, and working towards simplifying your business. You with me? Let's do this. Why, hello there, and welcome to episode 29 of the Small Business Made Simple podcast. Thank you so much for joining me again today. I know you have lots of choices out there of podcasts that you can listen to, but I really appreciate you lending me your ears and making me one of your choices. This week, we are going to be talking about all things Instagram, and I'll be taking you through a little bit of an audit of your own Instagram platform. If you tuned in to episode 28, we did a social audit on Facebook last week, and next week we'll be doing one on LinkedIn, which I have to say is my favorite platform of them all. It wasn't always that way, but I'll speak more about that next week. So let's get into Instagram. 9 million Australians are on Instagram. Of that 9 million, 57% are men, 42% are women, and these stats are as of May in 2019. 75% of users are between the ages of 18 and 44. And the biggest demographic, which equates to 32%, is between the ages of 25 and 34. So if your target market happens to fall into any of those stats, then this is definitely the podcast for you. But before we get all grammie, and that's me trying to be really cool, and my children say, please don't do that. But before we get into Instagram, let's do our discovery of the week. This week's discovery, you know, I really love a good little life-changing, making business simpler, because, you know, that is the whole reason for the podcast, discovery. And this week is a cracker. It's called fbdown.net. So basically, it is a way of downloading any video that you've put onto Facebook onto your desktop. So that URL again was the W's, F for Fred, B for Bob, down, D-O-W-N.net, fbdown. And it's a way of downloading your videos and things you've put on Facebook onto your computer. And it's really handy if you want to repurpose any Facebook lives that you might have done on the platform, or any videos that perhaps you might have shared to the platform but no longer have on your desktop, or maybe you've changed computers or whatever that looks like for you. It's really great for repurposing content. I absolutely love this, and I hope that you guys do too. You can thank me later for this great little discovery, or perhaps I should start taking thank yous in the form of podcast reviews and shares. Maybe we might do that. So if you want to say thank you for this great little discovery, maybe leave me a little review or share this podcast with someone else. As always, guys, just a little disclaimer. My discoveries are just that, and I am in no way affiliated with any of them, but I promise to tell you if I ever am. I just love them. I love that they make my life simpler, and I love sharing them with you and getting the response I get back from you guys, the listeners. Of course, if you have any discoveries yourself that you would like to share with me, please feel free to do so. Tag me on Instagram at Small Business Made Simple, or email me, jen@jendonovan.com.au. I'd love to know what you're using to make your life a little bit simpler too. All right, so let's get into the Instagram audit. I'm going to just, full disclosure up front, guys, here, Instagram is not my favorite platform. In fact, it's probably my least favorite platform. If I look at Facebook, LinkedIn, and Instagram, it definitely comes in last. I have built many, many profiles and businesses on this platform over the years, right from when it first came out. You know, I can't even remember what year it was, 09 maybe, or something like that, all the way to now. So I have built quite a few accounts on Instagram over the years, and I've always found it my least favorite. So full disclosure there, but I still do think it's a great platform. Does it work? Absolutely. Can you get people to follow you and interact with you who one day might do business with you? 100%. 100%. And that's exactly why I want to go through it with you today to make sure that you have your Instagram up to date, looking beautiful, all the points, all the I's dotted, all the T's crossed, so that you can make sure you're attracting the right people who will one day again do business with you, because that is the whole reason why we are on social media if we are in business. So let's get started, and we're going to start with your bio. Your bio is super, super important. It's your opportunity to tell how your brand can help others who are actually looking at it. So there's five essential key elements when it comes to your bio. First one is your biopic, and this should be you. Just like last week, it should be a recent photo of you. Having your brand logo in your biopic is not wise. You may get sick of me saying it, guys, but you've got to think H2H, human to human. Unless you have a national or internationally recognized brand logo, your biopic needs to be of a human, and it needs to be a fairly professional photo, but definitely in keeping of your brand. Again, no cats, no dogs, no partners, just you. Maybe if you have a team, you might like it to be your team, but it has to be a human. The second key element is the headline, and this is the part that's in bold. So if you look at your bio on your phone or, in Instagram, you will see that just below is a bolded headline. So besides your hashtags, this is the only searchable term you get on Instagram. Yep, it's the only. So this really matters. Make it count. Use words that describe your brand. By default, Instagram fills your name in there, but you can change it, and you really should. Unless your name is your business, and unless your name tells people what you do, then I think that it should be used in some really great keywords that are searchable. And as with everything on social media, done once is never done. And you might get a little bit sick of me saying this as well, but we should always be changing things up. As our business changes, as events come and go, as seasons come and go. And when I talk seasons, I don't mean summer, autumn, spring, winter. I mean the season of your business. What season? Are you in a big growth spurt? Are you in a change? There's all sorts of seasons. So as they come and go, things should change as well. The key thing here is remembering you need to use keywords that describe your brand. This is absolutely prime real estate here. And a bit of a pro tip, if the keywords you use don't fill up the spaces allocated to this headline, put some relevant emojis in there. It doesn't make it more searchable or anything like that, but it certainly does make it more eye-catching to any visitors that might be coming to have a look at your bio. So below the headline, of course, is the body, and you have 150 characters here, and we want to tell people what you do and what value they will get from your account straight up. So lately there's been a lot of talk as to whether or not you should put hashtags in your bio, and I'm asked this question a little bit. So the answer is yes and no. No, if you're doing it for search related reasons. You will not come up in searches because you have a particular hashtag in your bio. But if you've got a hashtag that's brand specific to you or some part of your business, then put it in your bio. So the idea behind is if you have an hashtag on you in your bio, it becomes a link. So people can click on that hashtag and they will go to the place where everything that has been tagged with that hashtag is. So they'll be able to see a collection of things. So if you had an event, for instance, coming up, you might have invent a hashtag that is very specific to that event. And after that event, or in the lead up for that event, or on the day of that event, people can click that hashtag out of your bio and go and have a look at all the photos that relate to that event. And of course, with events, it's a really great idea that, you could share that hashtag with the people coming along, and therefore as their photos are put up on social and hashtag with that hashtag, then of course that will come up under that hashtag as well. So that's the idea behind it, is it should be a hashtag specifically to you or a specific place you want to send someone because of the brand of your business or in some part of your business. It is not a searchable thing if you put a hashtag in your bio. You only get 150 characters here, and that's tiny whiny, isn't it? So you need to make it interesting. Use emojis to make sentences stand out, and maybe use emojis instead of words, and that can perhaps save on your word count as well. Remember white space. You don't want to have it so full that no one can quite read what there is there, or it's not pleasing to the eye. If you have space out of that 150 characters, write something personal about yourself, like maybe you're an almond latte lover, or maybe you're a donut person, or maybe you're you love a particular breed of dog or cat or something like that. If you can put something in there, again, H2H, a little bit human, another reason for people to connect with you and to follow you, then that is great as well. And if you're worried about word count, then maybe if, for instance, you're a donut lover, you could use the donut emoji and the love heart emoji to save some space or something like that. But people will connect with people who they believe have the same interests or values with them. So keep that in mind when you're writing your bio. Again, and I can't stress this enough, done is never done. Come back to here often, check it, change it, make it relevant to the season of business you're in. The fourth essential thing is you need a call to action, and this needs to be part of your 150 characters, and it should be the last line. In any marketing, you should never leave your prospect or your client or your customer wondering what to do next, and your Instagram bio is no different. If someone comes and looks at your bio, what do you want them to do next? For example, you might have something like, find your tribe ebook here with an emoji pointing down to the link. We'll get to that link shortly. Or you might have find out more here, or download X, or for sale items go to Y. Again, done is never done, and it needs to change as your business changes, but make sure you have a call to action within your bio. So the fifth essential thing is the link, and you only get one, except for when it comes to IGTV, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. I think the founders of Instagram went, so how can we make this really hard for marketers? And then they thought, I know, we'll only give them one link. That's all they can have. And just in case you're thinking, I'm not a marketer, yes, you are. If you are in business, you are in the business of marketing. So I'm not really sure why Instagram thought that having one link out was a great idea, but it certainly has made us think on our feet a little bit more. So you only get one link, and you need to use it wisely. You might use it to promote your latest project or your latest opt-in offer or whatever is your champagne thing that you want to offer to your new visitors. There's some really cool tools out there that can help, that can develop, that can help you have more than one link. And one of the most popular ones is Linktree. So you can go to Linktree or just Google Linktree, you will find it. Creating a Linktree account, and there is a paid and there is a free version, and the free is totally fine. It allows you to put that link into your bio, which then links out to so many other places, depending on how many places you want to send them. If you're not sure what I'm talking about, head over to @smallbusinessmadesimple, which is mine, and click the link and you'll see exactly what I mean. Linktree is fabulous, but to up-level it even more is to build your own on your website. So if you have a website, have a page that is like a Linktree, set up similar in that, it's one link and then they click that link and then they go to a page where they can choose other activities or can be sent other places. It just means that your website is then going to get that traffic. And of course, if we get traffic to our website, we can set up retargeting campaigns, we can put the Facebook pixel in there and serve them up ads. We can do so much more. But of course, if you've got the link in your link tree, then you're sending all the traffic to Linktree. So just have a think about that. You know, could you make a page on your website that has the same function as Linktree? So it is something I'd really love to do on my new website, which I will, of course, be launching in the very near future. A couple other things you might consider to put in your bio, depending on what type of business you have, might be your physical address, your physical business address, maybe a contact number or an email address. You've only got 150 characters, I know, and there's a lot to fit in there. So you'll have to have a little bit of a play and see what you can get in there and what's the most important things to put in there. So that's the bio and the bio photos done. I hope that has helped and given you a little bit of clarity. Remember, make it short and to the point, and done is never done. Always go back and change it up depending on what's happening inside your business at the time. So we're going to move on to hashtags now, and there is so much to say about hashtags. But hashtags are arguably Instagram's primary method of sorting and filtering content. So they are super duper important and not to be glossed over and not just to be put in willy-nilly. Before, when I was saying in your bio that highlighted, bolded bit, that was a searchable term. That and hashtags are the only searchable terms you get inside the Instagram platform. The good news is you get 30 of these little creatures to use. And of course, the biggest question I get, or the biggest two questions I get, is should I use all 30? And should they go in my comments or should they go in my post? And by post, I mean caption. I probably should use Instagram language, shouldn't I? So to the first question, should I use 30? And my answer is yes and no. Which is really typical, isn't it? I'm sorry. So yes, if you have 30 relevant hashtags that relate to the post you're putting on, then that's 30 opportunities to be found and to come up for that hashtag. My answer would be no. Clearly, if you're just hashtagging for the sake of hashtagging, the hashtags need to be relevant. Every expert out there in Instagram has a different thought and a different opinion. What's the sweet spot? Some people say it's around 12, other people say it's around 20. I personally think that you should hashtag. If you have 30 relevant hashtags, then use 30 relevant hashtags. If you have 8 really relevant hashtags, then use 8. But they just need to be relevant to what you are posting there and then. So the second part of that question was, of course, should the hashtags go in my caption or should they go in my comments? And I'm going to caveat my answer here by saying I don't think anyone really knows. It's a little bit like the Facebook algorithm. No one really knows how it works. So we are all testing and measuring, and that's exactly what I think you should do on your Instagram account. Personally, I think they should go in the caption, because when you post that caption, that photo, your words, your hashtags, that is when the algorithm starts right there. That's when it starts to give you love. And plus, I kind of look at some of the really big experts on Instagram, like Jenna Kutcher, for instance. And if you don't follow Jenna Kutcher, I highly recommend that you do start following Jenna Kutcher. She is amazing. And she, and like many others like her, they put their hashtags in their captions on Instagram. In fact, a recent study by Agora Pulse, which used 117 posts from 3 different Instagram accounts, which equated to 13,000 odd followers combined, found that the key takeaway is that when hashtags were used in the original caption, the reach was nearly 30% higher. So when organic reach is becoming harder and harder to achieve on social media, this sort of result should not be overlooked or undervalued. Plus, it is a little bit more time consuming to go back and put your hashtags in as a comment. And we all know we get distracted. And the last thing we want is to post and forget to put our hashtags on, because then our content seriously just isn't searchable for anyone. So my biggest piece of advice, of course, is test and measure for your account yourself and see which one works better for you. I think the trend of putting them in the comments started because people wanted their feed to look neater and nicer and more professional. And to that, I'd say it's really about engagement. Social media is always about engagement. Without it, you'll just be posting to crickets. So one last thing on hashtags, which is a biggie. How do you find them? How do you know what hashtags to use? So whether you use 30 or whether you use 10, and really, I think you should be using more than 10. There's a bit of a system that I use, and I split my hashtags into thirds. So again, whether you're using 30, you would have 3 lots of 10, or whether you had 20, you would have a 6, 6 and an 8 or something like that. But kind of split them into thirds. My first third is hashtags that have under 10,000 posts against them. So how do I know that? Well, if you search a hashtag, it'll actually, and click on it, it'll come up with the number of posts that are against that hashtag. And a bit of a pro tip, you should actually follow your most relevant hashtags. Just search them and then click follow. Easy as that. Okay, so my first third is posts under 10K. My second third are posts between 10,000 and 500,000. So they have between 10,000 posts against them and 500 posts against them. And my third third is big accounts. So anything over 500,000 posts against them, that's what I would call I would put in my last third, maybe I should say it like that. So why is this relevant? Well, I guess the idea between the hashtag system is to be found for that hashtag. So if all the hashtags you're using have giant numbers against them, then the chances of you being found for that hashtag are really small. And you're basically a tiny fish in a really big pond. And in marketing, we want to be the big fish in the little pond. We want to stand out and we want to be found easily. Please don't use hashtags for hashtags' sake, and please don't use them because I told you you had to. It does take time and it does take research, especially if you're serious about using the platform to gather a community of followers who, again, one day might do business with you. I actually save my hashtags in my notes on my phone, so then I can just cut and paste the relevant ones for the post I'm creating. That saves me hours of work, but of course, I've researched them first. There was a lot of noise late last year as well about how you shouldn't use the same hashtags in every post, which put the wind up a lot of people who were just cutting and pasting the same hashtags over and over again. And also people were out of their mind going, oh my God, I have to think of new hashtags all the time. I think that that thinking is flawed and really quite untrue to boot as well. If you have hashtags that are brand specific to you and your products and your service and your offerings, of course you need to use them over and over again. Why wouldn't you? It's exactly what you want to be found for. And here's the bit that you need to hear. If you're using the same hashtags over and over for convenience, then that's, and it's clearly not relevant for the post, then that's using them the wrong way. For instance, if you're posting a photo and a caption about your holiday on, say, the Gold Coast, and the hashtags you're using are like royal family and Kate and Will and things like that that have absolutely no relevance to the post you're doing or to the photo, and maybe you're just using them because they're trending right now and you think, oh, I'd like to get a piece of that, then that's a definite no. You need to make sure the hashtags are relevant to the photo and the captions that you're actually posting. A user that follows the hashtag, say for instance, again, if we take the royal family, if a user follows the royal family hashtag and they start seeing things from you popping up about a Gold Coast holiday in Australia, they can actually click on it and select don't show for this hashtag. And of course, that's really bad for you and your account. So that's why you need to make sure that the hashtags you use are relevant for the posts that you're actually posting at the time. All right, I will wind up hashtags just shortly. I think hashtags could have been a whole podcast episode on themselves. But you can, I just wanted to let you know that you can use hashtags in Instagram stories. Hashtag pages have Instagram stories on the top left-hand corner. So you can click on it and you can see a collection of stories that have been tagged with that hashtag from people's public profiles. If you're lucky enough to get your post in that hashtag story, that can expose you and your brand to a really big audience. There are two ways you can add hashtags to your stories. The first method is by using the hashtag sticker and changing the text. Otherwise, you can just simply use the hashtag symbol on your keyboard and type the hashtags out that way. You can add up to 10 hashtags to a story, but you have to make sure that you're not cluttering the content as well. So if you do a hashtag on your story, you can actually with your fingers pinch it all the way down, almost to the point where no one can see them. And sometimes, you know, you can hide them in the background if you change them to the same color as you've got in the background. Because no one needs to really see them, especially not 10 of them, but people will still get notified because of that hashtag. So just because you can't see it with the naked eye doesn't mean the algorithm doesn't pick it up. So wrapping up hashtags here, how do you find the right hashtags for your business? I'm really sorry. I'm going to tell you, you have to do your research. Basically, hop on the app, start typing into the search function in Instagram what type of hashtag you think might be good for your business and start making a list. And the really cool thing is if you have a look at a hashtag and start following the relevant hashtag. So if you go, say hashtag small business, if you hop on Instagram, have a look at hashtag small business, it'll actually start showing you some that are related to that as well. So you can build your list really quickly and really quite easily just with a little bit of research. Doing it that way is a really great way of finding relevant hashtags. It might be that might just be a little bit more niche for the hashtag that you were actually searching in the first place. You can always check out what hashtags your competitors are using. And if you sell brands, for instance, you might sell a clothing brand, check out what that clothing brand, what hashtags they use on Instagram. They possibly have really big marketing research budgets. So if they're using particular hashtags for that brand, then piggyback on that and start using them as well. Okay, I'm going to move on from hashtags. Like I said, I think they could have been a podcast in themselves. So moving right along, the other question that I get often is how often should I post? My answer is when you've got something valuable to say. Don't post 5 times a week with subpar captions. If you only have something valuable to share with your audience, maybe 3 times a week, then simply just post 3 times a week. It's not like when Instagram first came out, it was if you didn't post 3 or 4 times a day, you would just slip down the bottom and no one would actually see. That's not the way it works now. It's got an algorithm. So, you know, post when it's relevant and when it's valuable to your audience. However, I do think you should be posting stories every day. I'm really sorry. I said it. There it is. Sorry, not sorry. They are really quick and they are easy and they can be so engaging. Your audience will love engaging with stories with you, which only lasts for 24 hours. People love seeing behind the scenes. They don't have to be perfect photos. They don't have to be perfect captions. They just need to be relevant and engaging. And there are so many fabulous stickers available for stories, like polls and questions and quizzes and gifts. There's just so much that can help really make your stories really engaging for your audience. So just leading on from stories and noting that they only last for 24 hours, if you go to your bio, underneath your bio, you will have highlights. Now, if you don't have any set up, you'll see a round circle with a plus sign in the middle of it. That is the start of your highlights. So highlights are a way of saving stories. So stories only last for 24 hours up the top in those little round circles. But if you wanted to save it, you can actually save it to your highlights. This was a bit of a new feature back in 2017, I think. And again, it's a really great way of saving your stories and repurposing them so they last more than 24 hours. And apparently, I believe you can have as many highlights as you actually want to have. They're a really great way for people to see relevant and related content repurpose content, obviously, because they've been a story, and it's all in one place. For instance, you could have a highlight for motivational posts or for recipes you like or for podcast episodes or an event you ran or attended. You know, this will just allow the user or the follower or the prospect to click the highlight and run through just like a little bit of a storybook, I guess. So say it's a recipes, you know, it would be a way of having all your recipes in one spot or all your motivational posts in one spot or all your podcast episodes in one spot, or at least, you know, the story that is telling people about that. So how do you make a highlight? Well, I have to say that Instagram is a really, really visual platform, and I think it would be a little bit too hard to explain on an audio podcast how to make a highlight. So I've linked to an article in the show notes at socialmediaandmarketing.com.au to an article written by Social Media Examiner, which explains all about Instagram story highlights for business. So go over to my show notes and have a look at that link and have a read of that article, and it will show you step by step how to set up highlights. Okay, so before we wrap this baby up, let's talk about your feed and your captions. Your feed, so when I say feed, I'm talking about the place that you go to see all your posts together. So it's under your bio. So you've got your bio, you've got your highlights, and then you've got your grid, basically. So your grid is what I'm calling your feed. Your feed or your grid should look really engaging, 100%. It just needs to look engaging. The more higgledy-piggledy it looks, the less the user is going to have a good visual experience, and Instagram is all about the visual. You can buy templates for this sort of thing from places like Creative Market, which can help your feed look really good and really succinct and kept on brand. But the two things you really need to do that cost nothing is use a common color palette. So that could be your brand colors, and stick to your brand colors as much as possible. And if you use an Instagram filter, always use the same filter. So your photos always have the same look. Take Cadbury, for instance. Not all their photos have the signature purple in them, but their feed certainly has enough of it to look visually pleasing and to be on brand. So does your feed have to look perfect? I think it's less and less about looking perfect and more looking like a brand. So I'm not saying that every photo needs to be a professional photo, but I think if you can always use the same filter and you can stick to a color palette, then I really do think that that is more visually pleasing than just putting up things higgledy-piggledy. I'll say one last thing here, and this is a biggie. In fact, it's my absolute pet hate when it comes to someone's Instagram feed. And if I didn't spruik my podcasters clean, which means that I don't swear on my podcast, I would put a swear word in here. So my biggest bugbear with people's Instagram grids and feed is I don't know who they are. Who the heck is the person behind this Instagram? So here's your little Instagram challenge for today. Go to your feed, go to your grid, and tell me when the last time was that you posted a photo of you, you the business owner, you baby you. If it was more than 5 posts ago, then today's the day for another one. Seriously, I follow some accounts and I have absolutely no idea who these people are. I could walk next to them at the supermarket. I could be sitting on the table next to them at the restaurant, and I would have no idea that that was their Instagram account. And you might think, well, why does that matter? I don't need to know everybody who's on Instagram. Well, it matters because of referrals. It matters because of word of mouth. You know, those marketing strategies that cost next to nothing and yet can drive so much of your business income. Remember those? Well, I need to know who I'm recommending. I need to know who these business owners are. And you might think, well, just unfollow them. But I can't, because I'm in marketing. So I really need to wait for the day that they do actually put a photo of themselves on there. Anyway, I will move on and I will get off my high horse. But please, H2H people, human to human, people connect with people. I cannot say it enough. I know it can be really tough to put yourself out there. I was one of those people as well, but be brave, embrace who you are, and let the world see the wonderful people behind this awesome brand on Instagram. I promise you, it will lift your engagement, no questions asked. So let's have a bit of a chat about IGTV. This was seriously supposed to be the next big thing, and it was supposed to send YouTube packing, but of course it didn't. It hasn't failed. It just hasn't taken off the way Instagram thought it would. But I will say this about IGTV. If you have any video on this platform or any other platform, share it on IGTV. As long as it's relevant for your Instagram audience, you should put it on IGTV as well. It's easy to set up. It sits in the right-hand corner of your Instagram app, and it's another way of being found. And they do let you link out from there. So there's always a call to action that can be had when you do a video on IGTV. I think it's really important if you share video, then making sure that you have that set up as well. So let's get into captions. So caption is what you write under your photo. So every Instagram post, of course, has a photo and it has captions and it has hashtags. So let's have a bit of a chat about captions. Captions should tell me a story. Short one, long one, don't care. Just make it engaging and make it a story. Unfortunately, I'm going to say it again, H2H, human to human, has come back to haunt you here again. It's got to be engaging for humans, for people. If you have a yellow coat that's just landed, for instance, say you sell clothes and you have this beautiful yellow coat, don't tell me that it's a yellow coat made by brand X and its price is Y. Tell me a story. Maybe it's a short one that might involve the fact that it's been designed and made in Australia. Maybe the story is about the timeless piece that this could be inside your wardrobe, how it's an investment. Or maybe the story is last time it sold out because of X and now it's finally back in store, and tell me why you think it was so popular. You might not sell products, but you get what I'm saying, right? You're not selling the yellow coat or the course or the workshop or the book. You're selling the feeling to me, an outcome. You're selling me the solution to your problem. You know, tell me a story. Tell me why I need to engage with that post. No more bad slap it up with no energy or no thought captions anymore. So one more thing when it comes to Instagram and strategy for growing your following with people that one day might do business with you. We've discussed hashtags, we've discussed captions, we've discussed your bio and how important it is to get it right. But the biggest and best way to get traction on this platform is to, drumroll, engage with people. Yep, spending time on the actual platform, not posting and ghosting. And within the strategy of engaging is the all-important social media marketing strategy that I think is close to number one, and yet so many people forget to do it. It's the old reach out strategy. Yep, go and find people who one day might do business with you, people who fall into your who avatar, people that are your who, and start engaging with their posts and engaging with them through their stories, their captions, and even through the DMs, which is direct messaging on Instagram. So let's sum up. So when you're doing your audit review, you know exactly what you're looking for or you're looking at. So the first thing we spoke about was your profile pic, you, human to human, recent and on brand. The second thing we spoke about was your bio. So does your bio need some work? Does it tell me what you do and what you can do for me? Does it have a call to action? Is it short and to the point? And think about your only link on this platform. Where are you going to send them? Hashtags, you've got to go and do your research. They've got to be meaningful to the post and your brand. It'll take some time, but I promise it will pay off. They are crucial to be found and to be followed. Fourth thing we spoke about was your feed or your grid. It should be visually appealing. It should be on brand, and can I see you? I'm such a pain. I absolutely know I am, but I want to know you. I want to know the person behind the brand. And if your feed isn't what you want it to be, you can always archive posts. So basically, you just go to the post you'd like to archive, click the three little dots in the right-hand corner, pick archive. You won't lose any analytics from it, but it'll be hidden from your feed, and maybe then you can start designing the feed that you actually want. The fifth thing we spoke about was your captions. Tell me a story and no posting for posting's sake. And of course, we just wrapped up with engaging and reaching out. Before I finish up, some tools that might help you on Instagram. Planoly, Plan and Tailwind are all great scheduling apps, great for hashtag help, great for planning your grid and monitoring and tracking. I've got links to all those in the show notes as well. Square Lovin is really good for more analytics on your Instagram account. So we haven't really touched on analytics very much. I think the analytics that you get from Instagram are subpar. So something like Square Lovin can really help with understanding who you're attracting and what content is performing best. Again, link is in the show notes. The last little tip or trick that I have is, do you have your Instagram account, a link to your Instagram account in your email signature or on your blog? Is it connected to your Facebook business page or mentioned in your personal Facebook page? Is it on your website? The idea is to remember to put this link in as many places as possible so people know where to find you quickly and easily on the Instagram platform. And of course, talking about having yourself easy to find, have you ever looked at or ever used your very own name tag from Instagram? Not sure what I'm talking about? Well, if you go to your bio and click the hamburger menu at the top right-hand corner, which is the three lines, it kind of looks like a hamburger. I call it the hamburger menu, sorry. And basically click on the hamburger menu and then you'll see another menu pop up, and within that will be name tag. If you have a physical store, you could actually print this out and have it at your reception or your counter, or you could put it on your business cards. There's lots of uses for it. And of course, you can change the way it looks as well. So have a bit of a play with your Instagram name tag. There are so many more tips and tricks I would love to share with you about Instagram, but we just are running out of time and your time is precious. So what I've done is I've linked to a really great blog that I found. The link is in the show notes. So my show notes are socialmediaandmarketing.com.au, and it's basically a blog by Hootsuite all about Instagram hacks. There are some really great hacks and some awesome information in that blog. So I highly recommend that you head to my show notes and you get that link. Can you hear that I'm having trouble wrapping this one up? There's just so much to tell you, so much wisdom to pass on, and I really want to make sure that you're really clear with Instagram what you need to be doing. And it's really hard to wrap this episode up, but I've got to finish somewhere, and I think this is as good a place as any. So that was quite the episode. I hope you got lots of gold from it, but it is the end of episode 29. If you have any queries or questions or thoughts or tips or tricks, let's continue the conversation in my Facebook group, Like-Minded Business Owners. If you haven't joined yet, you are more than welcome. Let's do that. Of course, I'll be back next Thursday talking LinkedIn and having some more marketing know-how and another great discovery, of course. If you're enjoying this podcast, please don't forget to subscribe so you never miss an episode, and maybe even share it with a friend. You could always leave me a rating and review wherever you listen in. Those things are like gold for podcasters like me, and it lets other people know that this podcast actually exists. And a bit of a PS, if you've already left me a rating and review, you can always leave a second one. Just saying. Anyway, guys, stay on your game. Keep going for those dreams, because the world needs that special gift that only you have. Again, thank you so much for lending me your ears. I know you have loads of options, and I'm so glad, again, you picked me to be one of them. And always remember, my small business peeps, as my opening song says, there is no point in dreaming small. If you feel lonely, say it loud. There's no time like the present. Say it proud, be true, and let us see you for the star that you are. No point in dreaming small.